Hello everyone, this is Reverend John Turner for the Orange County Buddhist Church and the Vista Buddhist Temple. We will be observing our Shotsuki Hoyo monthly memorial service for March 6th, Saturday. Traditionally, every month, we gather to remember our loved ones and friends who have passed away during that given month. I will also be joined by Reverend Dr. Mitsumi Wondra. This is our order of service. We will be chanting Shoshinge Sofu style from page 69 to page 75. We won't be chanting the Nembutsu Wasans today, so we'll jump to page 81 for the Ekoku. Then we will have a moment of silence to remember and show respect to the over 500,000 Americans who have died from the COVID-19 virus. It's a very sad milestone that we've recently reached. And then I will give a Dharma talk in English. Reverend Dr. Mitsumi Wondra will give a Dharma talk in Japanese, and then we will close with announcements. So if you could please join me in Gassho. Namo Amida Butsu, 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 Namo Amida Butsu. Kimyo Muryo Junyo Rai Namo Fukashigi Ko Hozo Bosatsu In Ninji Zai Seiji Zai Obu Sho Token Chobutsu Jodo In Kokudo ninden shizen mak konryu mujo shushogan chotsuke udai guze kokoshi yui shi shoju jusei myo sho monji po Fu o mu ryo mu en ko mu ge mu tai ko en no shojo kan gi chi e ko fu nan nan ji mu sho ko cho
に近く小人説一切群情無故所本願名号少女号死神神行願に因上等学書大念案必死滅道願成就如来所依故修世唯説弥陀音楽会五浄苦悪事群情会法身如来如実言の乙一年期愛心普段本の特念犯文上逆法祭永入尿臭死入海一味世臭心高上昇後異の水波無明暗頓内心臓死運無上不真実信人天非尿に苦運無運無死下妙無安逆心謙虚大虚起即応調節合悪臭一切善幕本部人問心如来具勢願仏言古代諸下者善人名踏んだりけみだ仏本願念仏邪見虚満なく修行信行十字人に難難中死難無可思引導祭天地論へ中華自治意気思考層現代諸高聖書異明如来大勢大き釈迦如来如我僧一首五明南天寺如十乃至修道世質の罪悪無権善絶大乗無情法諸官義事諸安楽賢治難行六六信行異行四路乱億年皆仏本願次年即時入一条唯の上昇如来号王法内異具勢音天人菩薩論諸世奇妙無下古如来へ修たら賢人実高専王朝大誓願高有本願力栄光異道群上諸異心義乳苦毒大王海筆逆乳大栄修修 徳志蓮華造世界即所信如法上人有本の輪現人図入所寺恩寺大下本心論乱露天使上皇乱諸菩薩来三蔵流士十条教盆上専業喜楽法天神菩薩論中下報道因果見世願お元猫ゆたり少女子縁唯新人枠前本部新人ポーツ少知少知即涅槃必死無料孔明道小宇宙上海府家道釈景小道南小唯名上道活入満禅寺力縁言衆円満徳後感染症三不三心敬恩言増末褒滅道因一所蔵悪地偶勢死安如海小明化禅道徳明武将意高愛上三葉脈悪高明明語賢意念海入本願大地海行者少寿今後心狂気一年相応後用意大と逆三人即所法所史上落原心公開一内狂変気安如堪二歳尊祖修心反戦人法華二の小便入極獣悪人由意諸仏我薬剤異性集中煩悩諸現随不見乃無間上生我本誓願苦名不恐蓮民善悪煩不忍心修教所可遠修善若本願具悪世現来諸事輪廻華決起義上異所思即入若上無異楽一致信心異の入愚教内に修士と上塞無変極上悪道俗 じしゅう、ぐどしん、ゆいかしんし、こそせんす。なまんだぶ、なまんだぶ、なまんだぶ、なまんだぶ、なまんだぶ、なまんだぶ。
Please join me in Gassho. Namo Amida Butsu. 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 Thank you for chanting, and thank you for observing that moment of silence for over 500,000 people who have died from COVID-19 in the United States alone. So we just chanted the Shoshinge, Sofu style. This is the great verse by Shinran Shonen. He wrote this to express his deep understanding and appreciation for the Pure Land teachings. It's 60 couplets, 120 lines of 7 kanji characters each, written in Chinese, so 840 characters. And to this very day, we've been studying the Shoshinge and the collected works of Shinran, the Kyogyo Shinsho, trying to appreciate what he was trying to tell us. And I think oftentimes in the United States, we read Shinran, Zen Master Dogen, as if they were Western philosophers or Western religious theologians. But I'm always reminded that their writings were meant to be profound spiritual expressions of their understanding of what it means to be a Buddhist. So today, I wanted to talk about how we can interpret Shinran in the modern age, especially during this time of a great worldwide pandemic, and over 500,000 died in the United States. And I think many of the practices and the techniques and the strategies Shinran used during his time are more relevant now than ever. Sometimes people feel like maybe Shinran is a little bit pessimistic, but I find him very realistic. He's not idealistic. And I think during the times of the 2020 and 2021 and maybe 2022, living through a pandemic, I think makes his words more applicable to us. As modern people, we can identify more easily with his times and teachings. So I wanted to share this with you. On the left, this is maybe one of two images or paintings of Shinran that was done in person he actually sat for this portrait. And we'll discuss a little bit about this. This is, you know, in his 80s. And on the right, we have a wonderful modern interpretation of Shinran, young Shinran, looking at historical Shinran. So we have historical Shinran on the left, looking into the eyes of a modern interpretation of Shinran by Reverend Nori Watanabe. This is Nori Watanabe's appreciation of Shinran as a modern person. But we don't want to think of Shinran as a modern person. He lived in a certain time and context, and it's important for us to study him in that context and then be able to make it come alive, as Reverend Watanabe has done, by this image. So I found this quote that really struck me. It's by Reverend Dr. Kenneth Tanaka. He is a minister in the Jodo Shinshu tradition, and he observed something I thought that was quite profound. He said that his basic overall approach is to question the modern interpretations of Shinran and re-examine them using the very same documents on which they were based. In the studies of Shinran, there are two dimensions. We focus a lot on his biography, and we also focus a lot on his thought and doctrine, as contained in the Kyogyo Shinsho and the Shoshinge that we just chanted. However, in both cases, these modern interpretations have one thing in common. That is, they both rationalize Shinran to treat him as a person of the modern era. It is therefore necessary for us to place him properly in the medieval context where he belongs. So I thought this was a wonderful observation by Reverend Dr. Kenneth Tanaka. He was not a modern person. He's speaking to us from his own time. And I think if we can place him within that time, it better contextualizes what he was trying to say to us. And I always feel that context is everything. If you rip somebody out of their context, it's very easy to misinterpret what they're saying, or make constructions, brand new constructions, that were never intended. So I wanted to look at some of the main events that were going on in Shinran's life. He lived from like 1173 to 1263. So this is, you know, 800, 850 years ago. And during his time, not surprisingly, or perhaps surprisingly, in Japan at that time, he lived during great famines. There was great shortages of food during his time. Crops would fail. There wasn't enough to eat. Famines could also be caused by hurricanes or pestilence and bugs. So the food supply was always in jeopardy. Some years there'd be abundance, and sometimes there'd be grave shortages of food, and people would starve to death. Also, that we could identify with, is there were many epidemics during Shinran's time. There were no vaccines. There was no antibiotics. There was no medical science as we understand it today. So, you know, people died often. Families, entire families could die. Husbands would lose their wife and two children in the span of a week or two. So this was another very difficult thing. And then third, there was a lot of political and social upheaval. There was a battle for power, a struggle going on between the aristocracy and the samurai. So there was many wars, revolts, protests, a lot of anxiety and tension. So you could imagine that if you wanted to practice Buddhism, it was only someone who was an elite, someone who was in the one percenters, somebody who had a lot of leisure time to be able to spend at a monastery in isolation, meditating for hours at a time, every day, 7 days a week, chanting for long periods of time, circumambulating the Buddha for 90 days straight, climbing Mount Hiei. These were practices that could only be done by monks and people who lived in a monastery. It wasn't available to everyday people. Everyday people were too busy dealing with 1, 2, and 3, famine, epidemics, and political unrest. And I identify with a lot of these today. We're dealing with a pandemic. We've had great political unrest in our country. We saw a riot at the Capitol on January 6th. And we also have food shortages. People are having difficulty getting food. And there's been a lot of food banks and giveaways where people can drive through with masks on at a distance to collect food. There's also these three Buddhist questions that were monks and scholars were dealing with and trying to figure out an answer to it. And most of these had to do with the meaning of practice. There was a doctrine of sudden awakening. This is a positive doctrine that you might suddenly realize enlightenment. You might suddenly realize insight. But the problem with sudden awakening is when you practice, how can you tell if you're making any gradual progress? How do you know if you're getting anywhere? Sudden sounds good, but there's no time limit on it. You don't know its arrival time. You don't know its ETA. Is it going to be tomorrow? Or is it going to be on the eve of my death? So these were questions. We're practicing hard. We can't really tell if we're making progress because there's no gradual here. It's all sudden. It comes at with a bolt. And we wait and we wait and we wait. And then there was another idea of original awakening, that all beings contain Buddha nature. And all the prerequisites and all the practice has already been performed by infinite reality. And it's more a matter of realizing it, of seeing it. And if that's the case, then why do we have to practice if we're all originally Buddhas? And so they would debate this. Do you practice or do you don't? You may have Buddha nature, but it's just a technicality. It's an anecdote. It doesn't really impact your life. So if this is the case, then why isn't everybody becoming Buddhas suddenly? And then number three, Mapo, was an idea that when times are hard, the Buddha has passed away, we have his teachings, but it's very difficult to practice without the Buddha, the historical Buddha, being here anymore. How do we carry on the Buddhist tradition? When times are difficult, it's very hard to practice. We can't go to a monastery like the Buddha did. We can't sit under a Bodhi tree for 7 weeks and have people come and bring us food. So there was this sense that Buddhism was in danger and that it was winding down and it wasn't practical anymore during these times to practice as a monastic. So I have started seeing essays and articles like this in our modern culture. People are becoming less idealistic, less optimistic, I think. We're talking about millennials having a quarter-life crisis. And I've come in contact with a lot of Generation Xers at 30 and 40 years old, wondering what happened to my life. I didn't sign up for this. I'm trapped in my home. I'm doing gig jobs. Where am I headed? And people are starting to ask profound spiritual questions because this euphoric, wild optimism is being challenged by reality itself. And so on August 6th of this year, or past year, 2020, in the Rolling Stone, there was this article with an image of the American flag in tatters, and it says, "The Unraveling of America. Anthropologist Wade Davis on how COVID-19 may signal the end of the American era. The COVID crisis has reduced to tatters the idea of American exceptionalism." And he wrote this in August. He didn't write this in November or December or January. He wrote this back when maybe only 100,000 had died or only 200,000 had died. So this reminds me of the time of Shenron. How do you practice when you're trapped in your home and you can't go to temple and you can't go to a store to buy a bell or a zafu? I went to Amazon and looked for bells, and there are some there, but they're not the ones I wanted. It's hard for me to shop right now for Buddhist ritual utensils. And then I went to a seminar over the summer, and there was this slide called Radical Honesty. And the presenter said that there's a feeling that we can no longer assume there will be a future. Millennials are beginning to be concerned about extinction events, maybe by 2050. Zoonotic diseases are on the rise. This means viruses that jump from different species. So they think COVID jumped from bats to humans. And I don't know all the reasons why, but supposedly bats are a huge carrier of viruses. And it doesn't affect them, but they can jump. So they're worried about future pandemics, that COVID might be the beginning of a trend, especially with deforestation and climate change. We're coming in contact with species that we haven't before. This one is important. In my family, I have children who went to college. Student loan debt crisis is at $1.6 trillion. It's worrisome for baby boomers, too, because they would like to sell their house someday when they retire. And there needs to be a younger generation that can afford a down payment. There's also rising levels of depression and anxiety among teens. We've heard a lot about this with stay-at-home, school, and lockdown. And then this has been on the rise. The religiously unaffiliated, they're called the nuns, are on the rise among young adults. This is the fastest growing spiritual group is the nuns. And it's N-O-N-E-S, not N-U-N-S. So that makes a big difference. So what Shinran did, and Honen, there's an idea that the Bodhisattva cannot realize awakening until all beings are awakened, and that Buddhism is for all beings. And I think Honen and Shinran took this literally, that there has to be a way for everyday people to practice Buddhism. It can't just be for the wealthy and the elite and the 1%. For Buddhism to be true, it has to be true for all people. And there were many householder Buddhists who practiced during the Buddhist time, but this tradition was not emphasized. The monks wrote the texts and the monks ran the monasteries. And over time, it seems like this householder branch began to fade. So I wanted to show you this image again of Shinran signaling this change and this openness to everyday people. Shinran Shonen, this is in one of only two portraits painted while he was still alive. This one is entitled Kumagawa no Goei. It's the bearskin portrait. And it's hard to see, and I didn't notice it, but he's sitting on a bearskin rug. It's a dark square underneath him. And to me, I thought, well, maybe it's winter and he's cold. But this is a signal that he's identifying with everyday people. Butchers, fishermen, people that tan and hide leather. He's making contact with a dead animal, flesh. This is not supposed to be something a monk does, but this is what somebody does when they're leading a life that's every day. This is the normal way that everyday people live, and there's nothing wrong with it, and it's not a hindrance. That none of these things are a hindrance to the Buddha's power and Namo Amida Butsu and to realize awakening. And then this is another quote from Tricycle Magazine by Dr. Jeff Wilson from November 22nd, 2019. It's called Amida Buddha Welcomes All Refugees. So in some ways, we all feel like refugees right now from the COVID-19 virus. So this is what Jeff Wilson mentioned. Studying the teachings of Shinran, it's clear that the persecution, displacement, and poverty he himself experienced led him to feel solidarity with the neglected, the abused, and the refugee. Oral testimony records an event where he was invited to a feast, but did not sit with the high monks, as was his right. Instead, he went and sat among the commoners and novices, eating with them and treating them as peers, a major breach of medieval social protocol. So you may not realize it, but I'm a commoner. We're all commoners. We're all doing the best we can. And Shinran challenged Japanese religious and political hierarchy by sitting with everyday people. So I wanted to show you one of the great things Shinran did. In Japanese Buddhism, there's three things that are very important when it comes to Buddhist practice. One is the importance of place. Being in an ancient spiritual temple on top of Mount Hiei, this would be the importance of place, a very special place to go to. Number two, the ritual has to be reproducible. It has to be repeatable. You have to be able to do it over and over again. And third, there's some sense of purity that the monks, by staying away from meat and bearskins, had enough purity to give their practice potency and effectiveness. And what Shinran did is he emphasizes almost singularly the importance of reproducibility. It's not place. You can practice Namo Amida Butsu anywhere. And it has nothing to do with purity. The power of Namo Amida Butsu and realizing ultimate awakening is so sudden and so original that purity isn't an issue. And so Shinran would say that this defines a temple. This defines a spiritual dwelling. You take a sheet of paper, you take a sheet of cloth, and you write Namo Amida Butsu on it, and you hang it on the wall, and your space has just been transformed into a dojo, into a temple. So wherever you are, this is practical and portable and effective. And anyone can say Namo Amida Butsu. So the practices in our tradition are easy. The bar is very low. Anyone can do it at any time, at any place. And I think this is what makes Shinran's teachings much more relevant to me now. I feel I can't go to temple. I haven't been to OCBC. I haven't been in the Hondo in months. And yet I can still practice. So this is important. And I think this is what Shinran gave us. And I think his teachings are more meaningful and more practical and more applicable now more than ever. They no longer sound pessimistic to an idealistic public. They sound realistic and practical and pragmatic. And if you could please join me in Gassho. Namo Amida Butsu, Namo Amida Butsu, Namo Amida Butsu, Namo Amida Butsu, Namo Amida Butsu. And now we're very lucky to have Reverend Dr. Matsumi Wandra give us a Dharma talk in Japanese.
みなさま、3月の小月法要にお参りいただきましてありがとうございます。お元気でお過ごしでございますか？65歳以上、また医療従事者のためにですね、コロナワクチンの接種が始まっております。どうぞですね、どちら様もお大事になさりまして、お暮らしくださっているというふうに本当に心から願っております。まあ、早くにもこの今年は3月に、ね、なりましたね。まあ、3月になりまして、陽気がポカポカしております。昼間のドライブの中ではですね、やっぱりエアコンを、ね、かけたりしてますよね。まあ、そういうこの3月の嬉しいですね、春のまた春が来てくれたっていうね、ポカポカ気分。この陽気の中でですね、まあ、お寺の庭にあるですね、いろんな花々もきれいに咲き始めております。きっと皆様のですね、お家のお庭もですね、たくさんの花が咲いているのではないかなと思っております。 まあ、春といえばですね、皆様、代表選手は桜ですよね。まあ、桜はとても綺麗な花でございます。まあ、ソメイヨシノとか、いろんな桜の種類があるかと思いますけれども、今日はその桜にちなんでですね、法話をさせていただきたいと思っております。まあ、江戸時代の、まあ、最後の方ですけれども、良寛様という方がおられますんですけれどもね、良寛様という方は曹洞宗の、お坊さんでした。で、まあ、越後、その当時越後と言いました、今現在のですね、新潟県にお生まれになりまして、そして、まあ、普通のお家にね、生まれられたと言われております。で、まあ、有名な歌人、句を詠む人ですね。そして書道がとてもおきれいな字を書かれてた。柔らかい字を書かれておりますよね。そういうことでですね、大変、まあ、今でも良寛様のことはみんな知ってるわけですね。で、この良寛様はちょっとユニークな方でしてですね、やはりその自由というものをとても好まれたということなんですね。ですから、家を出てですね、無一文でですね、自由に生きた、そういう74年間のご生涯であったというふうに言われております。そしてとてもですね、無邪気な方だったらしいんですよ。ですから村の子どもたちとですね、かくれんぼのね、ゲームをしたりですね、とても素朴で優しいお姿の良寛様です。そして先ほども言いましたように、物に縛られないですね、家も持たずに、いろんな財産も持たずにですね、ひっそりと、まあ、質素に、生活をしていくことに喜びを感じられた方であったということですね。で、この、まあ、良寛様が桜を思ってですね、詠まれた句にですね、散る桜、残る桜も散る桜という句がございます。ね、もうお聞きになった方もあろうかと思いますけれども、まあ、桜っていうのは本当にこの春にですね、一瞬の間だけ咲いて、そしてもう本当に潔くパラパラパラパラパラと散っていくわけですよね。で、それまでやっぱり1年間ずっと一生懸命つぼみをつけてですね、この暖かい季節が来るまで待ってるわけですよ。その桜のことですね。ですからパラパラパラパラと潔く散っていく桜もあれば、まだ枝に残っている桜もあるけれども、でもその枝に残っている桜もいつか散っていく桜なんであるというふうに良寛様は読んでられるわけですよね。まあ、このことはどんな意味を持つのかと申しますとね、どうでしょうね。今も申しましたように、まあ、今どんなに美しく綺麗に咲いている桜であってもですね、いつか必ず散っていくんだ、そのことを心に留めておきましょうという意味が込められているわけでしょうね。まあ、皆様、私たちの日常を考えますとですね、この世の中というのはですね、また人生というのはですね、もちろんね、嬉しいこと、楽しいこと、喜びに思うこともたくさんございましょう。またそれと同時に、それ以上にですね、やっぱりいろいろな悩み事が多いことだと思います。お仕事のこととか、家庭のこととか、あるいは対人関係、子育て、また自分の将来とかですね、今まさにコロナとかそういう感染病、それに対して自分の健康のこととかですね、それから今後の、いわゆる自分が、いわゆるリタイアメント、大丈夫かしらっていうね、お金のこととかですね、いろんな問題が山積しているのではないかと思います。と思いますと、やっぱりまあ幸せ 喜びと思うことも多かろうと思いますけれども、またこういうこの問題となる、あるいは悩み事の方がですね、案外と多くこの身にのしかかっている毎日ではなかろうかと思うわけでございます。まあ、物事にはですね、必ず原因と結果があるというのがですね、仏教の教えであることはもちろんでございます。そして、無常と言いますね。無常というのは常ではない、無というのはない、常は常ということですね。無常ということは常ではないということです。ということは、この今の現状がですね、ずっと続いていくことはないということですよね。そういうこの無常というものに、いわゆる時間が止めることができないということになるわけです。そしたらどうやって私たちはこの人生を生きていけばいいかっていうね、この限られた命の中で、それぞれの結果に至るまでですね、いかに、まあ、自分の人生というものを充実したものにできるかということに、考えさせられるわけですよね。そして、やっぱり一生悔いの残らないものにしたいというのも、私たちそれぞれが願うところだと思います。そういうことでですね、いわゆる散る桜残る桜も散る桜と良寛様が言われておりますように、桜のようにですね、やはりこの一瞬一瞬をね、もう精一杯咲いてる、ね、桜の姿のように、私たちは今日いただいた命をですね、なるべく精一杯、ありがたく思いながら生活させていただくことがですね、明日につながっていくことではなかろうかと思うわけでございます、ね。そしてですね、もう一つ桜の句をご紹介したいと思います。これはですね、浄土真宗五戒山上人、親鸞上人様のお話でございますけれども、親鸞上人様は1173年に京都の日野の里というところで、ご誕生されました。で、9歳でですね、比叡山にある延暦寺というお寺がございますけれども、そこで天台宗のお坊さんとして得度を受けられたわけですね。で、これにはいろいろと事情がございます。生まれられた1173年っていう、まあ、時代はですね、まあ、その頃平安時代の後期なんですけれども、いわゆる貴族政治から武士政治に、だんだんだんだん移っていく、そういうこういわゆる政治的にも動乱の時代だったわけなんですね。ですから親鸞上人様のご一家というのは公家ですね、公家ですね。ですからお父様はその公家として官僚としてですね、宮中、平安時代の宮中でお勤めになっていたということです。しかし今申しましたように、この貴族政治から武士政治へ移行していく、そういう政治が本当に凄まじい、まあ、いろんな争い事があったんでしょう。またごたごたがあったと思います。そういう中で、残念にもですね、親鸞様のお父様、この方のお名前は藤原有則とおっしゃいますけれども、このお父様はこのいわゆる官僚のお仕事を失うことになるわけなんですね。そうしましたら親鸞様のご一家は大変です。生活していくことができなくなってきました。そういうことで、このお父様は息子さんたちをですね、お坊さんにしようというふうにお考えになったわけですね。それで親鸞様は9歳という若さですよ。まだまだお父さんたち、お母さんたちと別れたくない、そういうお小さい9歳の親鸞様がお一人でですね、比叡山の山に登られて、そして天台という天台宗のお坊様の得度を受けられたということなんですね。 で、その時にですね、小さい9歳の親鸞様がですね、比叡山のいわゆる発出をされております、その通りですね、自鎮歌唱というね、大変素晴らしい、まあ、お坊様の前でですね、私をどうか今日、天台僧にしてください、得度をいただきたいですというふうに述べられたわけです。そうしましたらですね、この自鎮歌唱さんはね、おっしゃったのはね、今日はね、もう夕方で遅いし、ね、もう暗くなってるでしょう。だから、もう今日はやめて、明日の朝一番にしましょう、とおっしゃったらしいです。そうしましたらですね、親鸞様はすかさず、こうおっしゃったんですね。明日ありと思う心のあだ桜、弱に嵐の深むぬものかは、明日ありと思う心のあだだくら、弱に嵐の吹かぬものかは、というふうに言われたということです。これはどういうことかと申しますとですね、明日ありと、明日があると思っていたら、今満開の桜はひょっとしたら弱の嵐、今晩大風が吹いて大雨が降って、この満開の桜は散ってしまうかもわかりません。だからどうか今晩私を得度に、どうか得度式に私を天台僧のお坊さんにしてください、というふうにですね、9歳の親鸞聖人様はおっしゃられたということです。素晴らしいですね。満開に咲いている桜でも、この夜中のうちに嵐が来て雨が降って全部散ってしまうかもわかりません。それと同じように、この9歳の私が今お願いして天台のお坊さんにしてください、得度お願いいたしますと申し上げている、この強い強い決意もですね、一晩のうちに変わってしまうかもわかりません。ですから、私の心が変わらないうちに、どうか今お得度をお願いいたしますとおっしゃられたのが親鸞様のお心であるということです、ね、え、私はこの明日愛と思う心のあだ桜、弱に嵐の吹かぬものかはという句を読むたびにですね、ああ親鸞様こんな9歳でこんなに決意が強かったのかなと思うわけでございます。ねえ、どうでしょうか。この2つの句、紹介いたしました良寛様と親鸞様の句でございますけれども、どちらもですね、やはり私たちの儚い生涯、そして、この移りゆく世の中に生きている私の姿というものが浮き彫りにされているのではないかと思うわけですね。そしてまた今残された人生をいかに生きていくかということを誠に考えさせられる、そういう句であると思います。もちろん自分自身が積み重ねてきた過去の経験、いろんな私たちは経験をして生きております。それを今生きているこの現在に生かしながらですね、そして将来につなげていくということが自分一人の力ではないということです。決して私たちは自分一人で生きているわけではないということです。たくさんの方々のお力をいただきながら、そしてもちろん仏様に支えていただきながら毎日を生かされているということに気づかされるわけです。そして今申し上げたたくさんの方々に支えられて生かされている自分、その中にはですね、皆様方のご家族の中、お友達の中、もう先立たれた方々、ご先祖様、お友達、いろんな方々がおいでになります。そういう方々がですね、今はこの世で会うことはできませんけれども、 仏様となられて、浄土の国から悟りの国からですね、私たちをいつもいつも思ってくださって、そしてこのように、初月法要にお招きくださって、共にお念仏を聞いて、共にお念仏をお唱えする、お唱えしましょうという教えに私たちを導いてくださっているわけでございます、ね、そういうことで、それに気づかされる時にですね、私たちは本当に、深い深い感謝の思いが湧き上がってくるわけです。本当に如来様に抱かれて先に浄土へ生まれた方々に私たちは導かれて、そして悲願、いわゆる悟りへと続くただ一つの道、それはお念仏の道でございます。その南無阿弥陀仏を共に歩んでまいりましょう、ね、そうしたことによってですね、いろんな悩み多い人生かも分かりません。また反対に楽しくて本当に嬉しい時もあります。そういう思い出を心に込めながらですね、そして深い感謝の気持ちを持って日々充実した生活を過ごさせていただきたいというふうにいただいております。本当にこの3月の初月法要にお参りいただきまして誠にありがとうございました。それでは皆様と共に合唱いたしまして、南無阿弥陀仏をお唱え申し上げましょう。南無阿弥陀仏、南無阿弥陀仏、南無阿弥陀仏、南無阿弥陀仏。So thank you very much for coming to the March Jotsuki Monthly Memorial Service. Please stay safe and well. See you again.
So I would like to go over the announcements. Dharma School for March 7th begins at 11 and ends by 11:45 is going to be the Fuji 1st grade, Kiku 5th grade, Sumire 6th, Hasu 7th, and Matsu High School. We also have a seminar coming up, Right Effort, Making Dharma School Classrooms Anti-Racist Environments. That will be on Saturday, March 13th, from 2 to 5. We also have a fundraiser. The Orange County Buddhist Church and Panda Express will be having a fundraiser on Sunday, March 14th. It's online, and there is a code you give, and 28% of the sales will be donated to the Orange County Buddhist Church. And this can be done over your phone, over the internet, all hands-free, online, and you can pick it up in your car. Or you could have it delivered to your home. We will also be having our Spring Ohigan Seminar on Saturday, March 20th at 9:30 a.m. on our OCBC YouTube channel. And we will simulcast both Nihongo and the English seminars at 9:30 a.m. And then we're also having another fundraiser at OCBC. We're calling it Let's Fill the Hondo. Reverend Wonder and I really need the support and attendance of and the friendship of people in the Hondo when we give our Dharma talks. So you can submit a photo of yourself, just like at the NBA games, and have a virtual you in our Hondo. So that is the information here. And lastly, we'd like to encourage people to become a member of both the Orange County Buddhist Church and or the Vista Buddhist Temple. OCBC is a thriving community made up of strong, unified families and individuals dedicated to creating an environment conducive of expressing clear values, developing strong interpersonal relationships, and a foundation of Shin Buddhist spiritual and cultural connection. So here is the OCBC website for membership and the Vista Buddhist Temple website for membership. So I would like to thank you very much for attending Shotsuki. Please join me in Gassho. Namo Amida Butsu, Namo Amida Butsu, Namo Amida Butsu.